Good evening, distinguished guests, colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Professor Adrian Stone. I teach here at Melbourne Law School, and I'm also Vice President of the Australian Association of Constitutional Law, which is co-sponsoring this event. And it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this conversation with the Honourable Chief Justice Robert French. I would like to begin with some acknowledgements. I'd like first of all, to acknowledge that we meet today on the traditional lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations, and we pay our respects to their elders past and present. I'd also like to pay my respects to some elders of the legal community and note that amongst our distinguished guests, we include a number of justices of the Federal Court and the Supreme Court of Victoria, and we're very glad to have you here today. Can I say how delighted we are to have the Honourable Chief Justice Robert French here tonight to reflect on his career on the bench of the High Court. This evening's event is not a lecture, but a conversation that will be led by Carolyn Evans, the Dean of Melbourne Law School, and Harrison Moore, Professor of Law. So you will, through the course of Professor Evans's questions, learn much about our very distinguished guest, but allow me to make just a few introductory remarks. Chief Justice Robert French was appointed as Chief Justice of the High Court of Australia on the 1st of September 2008, and it was the capstone of a truly extraordinary, distinguished and diverse legal career. At the time of his appointment, he was the judge of the Federal Court, having been appointed to that office in November 1986. He's a graduate of the University of Western Australia, and after practice both as a barrister and solicitor and at the Independent Bar in New South Wales, he was then, among other things, an associate member of the Trade Practices Commission, president of the Native Title Tribunal, deputy president of the Australian Competition Tribunal, a part-time member of the Australian Law Reform Commission, and I'm very pleased to say, from 2001 until January 2005, he was president of the Australian Association of Constitutional Law. He is a Companion of the Order of Australia, a Fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia, and the patron of the Australian Academy of Law. He has a long history of generous engagement with Melbourne Law School, and we're so pleased, proud and grateful to have him back here tonight to join us for this evening and what promises to be a wonderful event. I hope you enjoy this conversation. Please join me in welcoming Chief Justice Robert French.
Well, let me join with Professor Stone in welcoming you all here tonight and particularly welcoming you, Chief Justice.
Thank you.
Let's get straight into it. You started off at university studying science rather than law, and came to law a little bit later. Why science, and then why law?
Well, science seemed to me to offer unlimited inquiry into great mysteries and the promise of becoming a great theoretical physicist. And as the science course progressed, I thought that that promise was receding somewhat. In our third year, we were each required to give a seminar to our fellow students, and I was always interested in the cutting edge stuff. It was the stuff in between that was the problem. I chose as my topic the relationship between certain sorts of mathematical groups and elementary particles, because someone called Murray Gell-Mann had found that there was a mathematical group called a Lie group, and it seemed to fit the properties of a group of elementary particles, and there was a missing space at the top for something called the omega minus particle, which he predicted using this abstract group which had come out of nowhere, and anyway, he predicted its existence, and it was found to exist. So I gave a presentation about this exciting development to my fellow students, and at the end, the Dean of Science said to me, "You express yourself magnificently, but I'm not sure you know what you're talking about." And as I've often said to others, thus encouraged and qualified, I enrolled in law.
Have you ever, in your time as a lawyer, found, is the science degree still useful? Do you maintain
your interest? Oh, absolutely. And I remember one of the things that sparked my interest, 1964, as a secondary school student, I was one of two students sent from WA to the Harry Messel Science Summer School. And we had some wonderful lecturers, including James Watson, who gave us an account of the unravelling of the DNA molecule. But Messel was a hugely vociferous education promoter, science education promoter. And I remember him waving around this great big blue textbook for the Wyndham science curriculum saying, rather with a rather gender biased sort of expression, show me a young man in 10 years' time who doesn't have a science education, I'll show you a young man who has to be locked up for his own protection. Anyway, I was inspired by that sort of thing to get into science. But following on to the answer to your second question is yes, I think science education is useful for a lawyer from two perspectives. One, the exposure to the methodology, even if you've forgotten a lot of the content. It's the methodology and the culture of science that is hugely important. As something that can inform your reasoning processes. And secondly, there are lots of legal problems which engage with scientific or technical issues. And if you have some understanding of how to read a scientific paper or get your head around at least the essentials of what some expert is going to say or the line of questioning that you want to take, then it is very useful. And I might say I tried to exploit my physics degree with enthusiasm from the very early stages of my practice. Can I give you one example?
Please.
It's, sorry, sometimes these are war story things, but there was a fellow that asked me to represent him. He'd been a law student at the university. Many years later, he was struck off. He was charged with riding his motorbike at 70 miles an hour in a 35 mile an hour zone. Now, this is before we even had, you know, kilometres. And he was absolutely clear that he'd only been travelling 35, which was the limit. And he'd been picked up on radar. Now, the way the radar guns operated then, the principle's basically the same. They send out a beam of radar, and it hits the moving object and is reflected back. And it shifts its frequency according to the velocity of the moving object, called the Doppler effect. And the two beams are combined, and you then get a thing called a beat frequency, which is a function of velocity and so forth. Anyway, there was some literature around that said if you got two moving objects in the same beam, you know, they could produce confusing results. And then I remembered something from my physics, and that is that the speed of a wheel at the top is exactly twice the speed at the middle. So 70 mile an hour at the top, 35 mile an hour in the middle. So I recruited one of my friends from physics who was doing his PhD, and we turned up in the magistrate's court.
Poor magistrate, mustn't
with a bicycle wheel and a radio frequency generator and a couple of oscilloscopes, and proceeded to demonstrate the possibilities. The magistrate, unfortunately, really wasn't across physics at all, and resolved the case by sidestepping all the technical evidence and saying, "I accept the police estimate of speed." Which was probably a just outcome. More seriously, there were quite a number of cases in those days involving the breathalyzer, and there was a lot of science around that, around the assumptions on which the breathalyzer operated, about the rates at which alcohol was absorbed into and eliminated from the bloodstream, and the relationship between the amount of alcohol vapor in your breath and the alcohol in your blood, something called the partition coefficient. I got across the literature on that, and we were able to call the chief crown pathologist, actually, as our principal defence witness, because a lot of the stuff that had been written into the regulations had been done on the advice of the chief crown chemist, who is his great scientific rival. So having the chief crown pathologist as a defence witness was a huge plus. He was a feisty Scotsman, and I can still remember a police prosecutor getting very frustrated seeing his case go down the drain as this fellow was. He said, aren't there people, a doctor, in your profession that disagree with you? To which the doctor replied, there are peculiar people in every profession, Sergeant, even yours.
Well, it sounds like you had a colourful early career at the bar. What made you decide to, having done both law and science, was it an obvious track to come into the bar, or were you tossing up about your career before you, when you left law school?
I was tossing up at the end of law school. Of course, WA is a fused profession, and so I didn't go straight to the bar. I went. In fact, I only practiced solely as a barrister in the last 3 years before I was appointed to the federal court. But in my practice, from the time of admission, I did principally advocacy work. When I finished law school, I wasn't sure that I wanted to become a lawyer. I had really gone into law because of the wide range of options that it offered. One of the possibilities I considered was foreign affairs. And I think I'd been selected for an interview, but I decided then maybe what I should do is just do my articles, which was the 2 years of training that existed at that time, and then see where I want to go, having got the full qualification. And I found that when I started my articles and I was engaged with real people and real problems, which had potentially legal solutions, my motivations about law and its application were transformed. Mm-hmm. And nothing really has changed since.
And one of the things that caught your interest and attention reasonably early on was the issue of land rights, sort of Indigenous rights. You were involved in setting up the WA Aboriginal Legal Service in the 1970s. Later on, you were the first administrator of the National Native Title Tribunal. Tell us a little bit about your motives there and what you learned.
Well, at the university, I'd been involved as a sort of small L liberal with the University Liberal Club. Mm. One of the issues that I saw as central to that sort of political affiliation was an antagonism to race discrimination. And in fact, in 1972, I was chairman of the Campaign Against Racism in Sport, which was organising demonstrations against the racially selected tours. Very polite middle class demonstrations, nothing like running onto the field. And one of the things we were doing were writing letters to, also to ministers for police, ministers for justice in WA, saying there should be special training for police and justices of the peace who have to deal with Indigenous people because of the particular problems. And that was back in the 70s. Mm. How I got specifically into the Aboriginal Legal Service development was through my candidacy as a Liberal candidate. I stood against Kim Beazley Sr. for the seat of Fremantle, which had been a Labor-held seat since forever, as far as I can remember. I think he got 60% of the vote and I got 32%. I said the swing against the Liberal Party was less there than anywhere else in Australia. But one of the groups of people that I met were the rather unlikely Melville Attardale Ladies Branch. And the president of the Melville Attardale Ladies Branch was a remarkable woman called Aoli Burkett, who had been one of those nurses that had been captured during the war in Singapore, and there was a book about them called White Coolies, I think, and remarkable woman. Anyway, she and a group of her friends had attended a UWA summer school on a new era for Aboriginal fellows, for Aboriginals, and they set up a new era Aboriginal fellowship as a result, and it was a collection of women of different political ideologies, and I got interested in it through my contact, my political contact, and ended up setting up with some others what we call the Justice Committee. And to cut a long story short, the Justice Committee morphed into the Aboriginal Legal Service of Western Australia. And there are some really remarkable people involved in the early days. George Winterton was a key figure. Philip Clark, who was later the inaugural Dean of Law at Deakin University, who was a UWA graduate. People like Fred Cheney, Ron Wilson, John Toohey were all involved. And I remember in, I think it was 1972, we'd been asking for the then government, for the McMahon government, for some money just to run a duty counsel service, $3,000 or something. And the government changed it. Suddenly we had this letter from Gordon Bryant, as I recall, asking how much we would need to represent Aborigines throughout Western Australia. So it was a bit of a game changer. We then set up an office in Port Hedland, and our first full-time lawyer up there for a year was John Toohey, QC, who was then the leading silk at the Western Australian Bar. Went up there with his wife and six of their seven children and made a huge impact. He was followed subsequently by Henry Warwick, who became a Supreme Court judge, then Peter Dowding, who was later the Premier of Western Australia. One of the people who worked with the ALS for a time was Trevor Riley in the early days, who later became Chief Justice of the Northern Territory. So there was an extraordinary array.
That's marvellous. And then the National Native Title Tribunal. Tell us a little bit about your experiences there. Well, it's a bit rocky at various times.
Well, yes. I was approached to become president of the National Native Title Tribunal in 1994. The Act was passed at the end of 93. And at first I was a bit uncertain about doing that. I thought that this was going to take me out of the mainstream of judging. But then, on the other hand, I thought maybe that's not such a bad idea for a few years to get a different sort of experience. And it was a radically different experience. It was the experience of being an administrator of a public authority which had to put in place a new and highly contentious piece of legislation. And it gave me some sympathy for administrators who are placed in that position and who are being continually judicially reviewed as I was. In fact, in one of my decisions was to refuse registration of a native title claim. It was an administrative decision. I was very concerned about the credibility of our process and that there were lots of claims being lodged which were generating all kinds of concerns and difficulties and they really didn't have any merit. Anyway, I rejected the claim in far north Queensland, and my rejection of the claim was on the basis of historic pastoral visas. This is pre-WIC. And it was upheld in the full federal court, but the High Court, in a case called North Ganalanja, overturned it with great rapidity and passion. In fact, they gave the decision on the spot and then gave reasons later. And there were, this was my criterion for testing the registrability of native title claims was in issue. And there were Indigenous people in the court wearing T-shirts which said ban French testing. So, yeah, the atmosphere was pretty electric. One of their leaders was Marindu Yana, who was quite a well-known character in far north Queensland. And I saw him sometime later and asked him, could I have one of those T-shirts? He said, no, you cost me a whole lot of money. So.
Well, let's turn then to your time as a judge. And you were appointed very young, you were in your 30s. Did you have any qualms about accepting when you were asked?
Not really. I was 39 and I had a reasonably extensive practice in the federal court and I was comfortable with that court. And the great attraction of it for me was that it was a national court. And as a practitioner from Western Australia in those days, certainly developing a national practice was not sort of not necessarily a likely development. Whereas this national court with judges from the bars of all the states and some of the best of the bars from various states with an expanding and potentially expanding civil jurisdiction was very attractive and in areas that I was interested in, the judicial review area, the competition law and then the Commercial Law, the Trade Practices Act, which I'd done quite a bit in. And I'd been actually a part-time member of the Trade Practices Commission for 3 years, so I got a sense of the interest attached to the intersection between economics and law in competition law. So when I was approached, it was in fact Pat Brazel, who was then the Secretary of the Attorney General's Department, who rang. And I said, after consulting with my wife, and we were both a bit concerned about the salary, which was pretty ordinary in those days, I agreed to do it. And it was, although there were, it was difficult initially because we had a young family, and my wife was sort of working part-time. Anyway, that had soon ended. She went back to full-time work. Became a district court judge and so forth. But despite those initial difficulties, I never regretted it. And it was 22 years on that court of great variety and interest. And with, of course, the five-year interregnum as president of the National Native Title Tribunal. And I had the great experience of working with some some great Australian judges. Nigel Bowen, who was the first Chief Judge and later became designated Chief Justice of the Federal Court. People like John Lockhart and Brian Beaumont and Trevor Morgan, a whole array of fine judges. I see Bruce De Bell here, so I must mention the South Australians, Bob Fisher, and a number of others. And Ray Northrop from here in Melbourne. And then, of course, as the generation, whole new waves of very interesting people that I work with. And the surprising thing was that despite the spread of the court around the country and the the 40-odd people that were on it, it was remarkably collegial. Mm. We came together as full courts, of course. We did both trial work and full court, came together as full courts, and we had meetings twice a year. The meetings were great events. They were. Nigel Bowen presided over them like an old-school politician. He'd been the Minister for Foreign Affairs and so forth, Attorney General. And although on one occasion he was challenged by a Queenslander. The Queenslanders were all a bit feisty, always a bit feisty. And Nigel Bowen once said, after we discussed some proposal, "I think the feeling of the meeting is," whereupon the late Justice Pinker said, "What do you mean, the feeling of the meeting? Is that what you think, or do we get to vote, or what?" So people had to stick their hands up, but it was a great court to be on.
How do you think you managed to get a diverse group of people across the nation? What was it that allowed it to come together as a single national court?
I think there was a sense of common purpose, and there was the interest in the diversity, the very fact that you could move around different places. We were all coming together in different capitals as full courts. So sometimes it'll be me sitting in Perth on a full court, and say Jeff Spender might come from Queensland, and somebody from South Australia or Sydney or whatever. We were always sitting together, not regularly the same group of people, but different mixes, and you'd get to know each other, and we would have, you'd have people to dinner at your house, it was just a lovely collegial experience with very, very high quality judges, in my view.
Mm. Well, we've got some ambitious young people and perhaps not so young people who might think themselves well suited to judicial office. What advice would you give to somebody who is just starting out as a judge?
Well, I think these days there is a lot of advice which is available to people who are just starting out as judges. The National Judicial College, for example, runs schools on how to manage your time, how to manage stress, how to write judgments, a whole lot of stuff that didn't exist in my day. I think depending on how much control you have of your own docket, you need to be aware of not overcommitting yourself in the sense of doing back-to-back cases and not leaving enough time to write judgments. Now, there are some people who don't have much choice. They're in courts where they don't get enough time to write judgments, and then because they're doing crime one day and civil the next, and the judgments tend to back up. So there is that business of time management, which is a very early issue that you've got to get across. Another issue is not overwriting. When I started out, I wrote a number of learned judgments on the criteria for granting leave to interrogate in civil proceedings. And I remember Paul Finn used to tell me that I was the most cited author in the most boring part of the CCH, practice reporter. And in the end, I got so thoroughly sick of interrogatories that I would say to litigants or their representatives, "You don't get leave to interrogate unless you satisfy me that you've done all you can to agree all the facts that you would have to have admitted anyway, and then if there's some sticking point, then you can come back." Because people used to get cross-examined before me on their interrogatories, and there'd be the ring of truth in his answer. I said, "Well, the solicitor wrote that down, and I just signed it like he told me, you know." People really... So they were of limited utility. So overwriting in procedural areas is part of the experience, I suppose, of growing up as a judge and then learning what was important and what was not, and then starting to focus on managing the cases to try and contain the factual issues and make sure that we didn't get bogged down in irrelevancies. That's a skill which you only really learn by being a judge, although there are techniques that you can be taught, but really you have to do it, and you have to develop the confidence and authority to do that.
Mm. And I suppose one of the ways that people do that is looking at more experienced judges, and you've talked about some of the great judges you've worked with. Were there any particular people that you admired or saw as a bit of a role model in your early time on the courts?
Well, there were people I'd observed when I was a practitioner, first of all in Western Australia. One of the early lessons that I learnt was the importance of courtesy coupled with firmness on the bench. Now, we did have a bit of a tradition in Western Australia at one time of impatient and rude judges. And it used to be very stressful for practitioners and for litigants. And I experienced a little bit of it. I saw some of it in action in some of the courts in Western Australia from time to time. And I described it as a kind of white noise in the litigious process. It's static. It gets in the way of the function. Mm. And really, it's something which is adverse to the proper exercise of the judicial function. One of the people who was, I think, an exemplar of the right way of doing things was a Chief Justice called Lawrence Jackson, who was appointed very young. He was initially an industrial court judge, and he spent many years as a Supreme Court judge, and then he became Chief Justice, and I appeared before him on a number of occasions. There's a general view that the whole culture of that court changed after his appointment, there was no longer a Chief Justice who was sort of cranky on the bench for whatever reasons. And whilst, you know, you had to be well prepared and timely and all the rest of it, and he was firm and authoritative, he never lost his temper and never showed signs of impatience. And that culture persisted. His successor, Sir Francis Burt, was an intellectual leader at the bar and on the court, and he was very, very concise and a formidable person to appear before. But at the same time, there was that culture of courtesy. He could be quite disconcerting sometimes. He had a ruthless sort of pragmatism. I remember appearing before him once when he was presiding on the Court of Criminal Appeal, and I had found an unreported decision of that court, which was right on point in favour of the case I wanted to make, and I quoted this decision to Sir Francis and his colleagues, and he looked at it and said, "Well, if we decided that, we were wrong." So I had to move on to what I call Plan B. But I do remember him saying once that the closest he came to being rude was when he once said to a rather loquacious witness, he was a very confident businessman, he said, "I don't think anybody's ever told you this before, but you talk too much." And so there were, and I saw that that model of courtesy was also replicated by people like Nigel Bowen and John Lockhart and so forth on the federal court, and it was a good thing to see. And so I took it as something that I should try to follow, both as a judge and subsequently, of course, as Chief Justice.
And I think as we're more and more conscious of issues of wellbeing and some of the psychological damage that's sometimes done by legal practice, those issues of courtesy and appropriate behaviour have just become more and more prominent in people's
and
lives.
If you just want to set it at a lower but equally important level, it's just dysfunctional. The court doesn't work properly when people are distracted by their stress because somebody's being rude. Yeah.
Well, before we move on to the High Court, one of the other roles that you had was as a judge of the Supreme Court of Fiji for 5 years. So that must be, and a number of Australian judges, of course, sit on courts or have sat on courts around the region. Must add a level of complication in most of these cases. You're sitting in Australia in a culture you know, in a society that you're part of. What was it like sitting in the court in Fiji?
That was a terrific experience. I was appointed as one of the sessional Australian members. They had sessional members from Australia and New Zealand, and the sessional members from Australia were from really the Federal Court and the Supreme Court of New South Wales. We would sit in, you know, usually I would find myself sitting with one or other of the, might be the New Zealand judge, and almost always, but not always, the local Chief Justice, Daniel Fatiaki. The law we had to deal with was not sort of unique or different. I mean, it was common law and statutes. Mm. There were a lot of statutes. There was a penal code. So the concepts were not unfamiliar. Of course, it was all embedded in a rather complex society. As we know, there were a series of coups, and there was a constitution drawn up, which I think was 1997, and it had some expert advice, including Cheryl's inputting into it. It had a very nice set of guaranteed human rights and all sorts of other things. There was one mistake made, I think, and this wasn't by the architects of the Constitution, but a compromise at the last moment by... This was post the 1987 coup, when it was decided that they would have electoral rolls which were ethnically based. And this meant that you had one roll for the Indo-Fijians and the other roll for the indigenous Fijians. And these two community groups were really under... pinning, if you like, the political fracture lines that ran through that society. And what it meant, I think, was that the political parties that were contending tended to be either the Indo-Fijians or the indigenous Fijians, rather than a mix-up of both of them in both of the political parties. So there was that complication. And in fact, while I was still a judge of that Supreme Court, which was the final appellate court, they had the military, interim military government established itself by effectively a coup in 2000 and 2006. And later on abrogated the constitution. Now they have a new constitution, and it'll be interesting to see how it works. But the experience of being a judge on the court was terrific. I remember on one occasion, and surprisingly, one or two of our cases gained some international acceptance. I was sitting on a case once with Sir Kenneth Keith, who was later a Justice of the International Court of Justice. He was from New Zealand. And I think I was sitting with, might have been John de Von Dusse, was the other judge. And this was actually a case which had started with the Chief Justice Fatiaki when he'd been a trial judge. It was a contested chiefly election. So they have elections for chiefly roles, and these, well, sometimes hotly contested. Anyway, this contested election had led to a whole line of collateral litigation, judicial reviews of this and that, and one of the contesting parties had lodged a private criminal prosecution against the other for alleged perjury in the course of a judicial review proceeding arising out of it all. And the DPP had taken over this private prosecution and then, under a constitutional power, nollied it. And the question before us, what is the reviewability, if you like, of the exercise of prosecutorial discretions? We had a very good Gerard McCloy, I think it is, who took us through a whole lot of comparative law about review of prosecutorial discretions from all around the world. And we wrote a judgment, Marta Lulu and the DPP, and I thought that was the last I was going to hear or see of that judgment. And then up it pops in, quoted extensively in a judgment of the Privy Council by Lord Bingham, coming out of Jamaica, and then another one from Trinidad and Tobago, and another one from another one of the Caribbean states. Then it's quoted in the House of Lords in a serious frauds office case involving the discontinuance of a prosecution which was going to embarrass them with Saudi Arabia or something. And then more recently in the case involving, I think, Lord Carlisle, and it's been quoted in New Zealand and in Northern Ireland, so...
its fame has grown.
that was the greatest case we ever sat on. Then we did have a human rights case. Now, this is the... Naturally, Australia being a bit thin on guaranteed human rights under our constitution, we don't get to see a lot of it, but I did get to see the presumption of innocence under the Fijian constitution. And unfortunately, what it concerned was an English silk's costs. So somebody had been charged with a corporate offence. An English silk had appeared and had the charge knocked out right at the beginning because of the acquittal of some co-accused. And then they applied for costs under a provision of the Penal Code or the Procedure Act or whatever it was that said you can get costs if the prosecution was unwarranted on the fact or unreasonable in law, some formula like that, and their costs were refused. And the argument was that the costs provision was inconsistent with the presumption of innocence because you had to effectively prove you're innocent in order to get the costs. We dismissed that. I think we called it constitutional reading up. The fees, as I recall, were something in the order of 500,000 Fijian dollars, which was a bit much by Fijian standards anyway. Anyway, it was a junior was sent out to argue the case before us, but that was about the only human rights case we got under that constitution.
The human rights of QCs, important human rights too. Well, let's move to the High Court now. Tell us how you were appointed as Chief Justice. When did it happen and how did you feel about it?
Well, as you all know, there's an interesting process goes on leading up to the appointment of a High Court Justice and a Chief Justice there. The newspaper journalists talk to their friends who give them the usual suspects and they have a list and then the list starts to contract as time goes on. In Sydney, I think, they have a recognition of the achievement of what's called making list. So if you're a Sydney barrister who has made list, it means you've been mentioned in the paper. They talk about it in the lifts as they go up and down. I'd made list along with a few others. There was a very extensive consultation process that year. Robert McClellan was the Attorney General. The statutory requirement for consultation for an appointment to the High Court is basically limited to the Attorneys General of the states and territories. But McClellan decided he would consult much more widely than that, and he consulted with chief justices, bar associations, law societies, with the law deans, with the legal aid commissions, and I think also with the women lawyers. Mm. And they ended up with a list of about 24, and then that was apparently contracted to a short list of three or something. And so there was quite a lot of speculation as to who was going to get it. And it's a curious experience when you're a spectator. You feel like a spectator at some game in which you're not involved. Anyway, I had been to, it was July of 2008, and I'd been to a seminar put on by the Aspen Institute. In Aspen, talking about, they usually sent a token Australian across to talk with Americans about peace and society and justice and so forth. And I came back and got back to Perth, and I was in Perth in my chambers, and I recall, I think it was about the 28th of July or a day or two before that, and my mobile phone gave a little belch and there was a text message. Would you please advise when the Attorney General can ring you? They must have thought I was still in the US. I love telling this story to American audiences because they have such a fraught appointment process. My first approach was by text message. And anyway, I rang the Attorney General and he asked whether I would be prepared to accept appointment. And obviously I said yes. And then the process that followed was to submit it to Cabinet. There'd already obviously been some sort of debate and small-p politics going on within the Cabinet, the detail of which I never really got across, and it's not really much concern now. That would happen, and then a couple of days later, it would go to the Governor-General, two ministers, that was going to be McClelland, I think, and Stephen Smith would go and present the recommendation to the Governor-General, and the Commission would be signed, which was the following Wednesday, which I think was the 31st of July. I think they held a press conference in the afternoon. That's when the announcement was made, which gave me almost exactly 1 month's notice before I had to take up the job. So there were a few things to tidy up before then, being a serving federal court judge.
Speed judgment writing,
yes.
You were, of course, appointed as Chief Justice. How do you see that role? That there's, of course, much that's in common with any of the justices on the High Court, but what do you think is distinctive about that role? What have you tried to bring to them?
Well, I think, first of all, the Constitution says very little. It just says there shall be a Chief Justice and such number of justices as the Parliament shall appoint. There are some obvious things. The Chief Justice presides when the court sits and the Chief Justice is sitting, so you're the senior judge. Beyond that, the Chief Justice chairs the meetings of the justices when they meet administratively. The management of the court is vested in the justices collectively, not in the Chief Justice alone. So that we have a business meeting, for example, at each sitting, which effectively is once a month, and I chair that meeting, and I chair various committees. So there's that role as we're chairman of the board, and then there's the communication with the administration. We don't have a huge administrative burden in the High Court. I think we have about the equivalent of 67 or something like that full-time staff, not a big budget. It's not like, say, the Lord Chief Justice in the United Kingdom or the Chief Judges of the circuits in the US, who have responsibilities for a whole array of courts below them. Then there is the being a point of communication with government. So if we have a funding issue or if we have an issue about legislation that affects the court, I'm the one that writes to the Prime. Typically, I write to the Prime Minister and copy in the Attorney General. I also have a representational role, obviously, through speeches, lectures and so forth, which is perhaps a bit more than the other judges. Now, so far as the actual judicial function is concerned, I propose the cases that we will hear in any given sitting and the judges that will make up the bench. Ordinarily, we'll set five, unless it's a constitutional case or we're going to be asked to re-examine an earlier decision, in which case we'll set seven. And I circulate it under the heading proposal. So it's a proposal, and this reflects the collegial character of the court and the fact that the Chief Justice cannot tell anybody to do anything. The Chief Justice is one among equals. I think that even the term first among equals is probably a bit risky if I deployed it with my colleagues. When there's a case, I sit on probably more of the cases than the others. I will occasionally have arranged the list so that somebody else is, the next two senior judges have a go at presiding. When we've finished the hearing of first of all, at the beginning of each sitting, each 2 weeks in, we would have a conference in my chambers, and it's a very informal conference. So we're sitting in armchairs like this, and we will talk about the cases for that week. And we'll discuss the issues, and nobody's locked in, because obviously we've all read these submissions, and we talk about, you know, people have provisional views, and we talk about issues that might be important, others which might seem to be distractions and so forth. So there's that kind of very informal discussion. And then we go on to, and we'll talk about the cases just for the 1 week, and we do the same exercise the following week. After the case has been heard, we'll come back to my chambers, and we'll have a cup of tea, and we'll sit around again and talk about the case. And then if a consensus emerges, let's say there's a clear majority at least, I will suggest that one particular person write a first draft. Now, this is not like the Americans. This is not a formal power of assignment. In the US, the Chief Justice or the senior judge in the majority has a formal power, or so it's treated, of assigning the writing of the opinion of the court to a particular judge in the majority. And then what happens is, ordinarily, that the person who agrees to do the first draft, and I try to rotate that, obviously, although sometimes there's a person who has particular expertise, particular interest, and you'll assign them, but you want to make sure there's a fair distribution of writing, because Chief Justice Gleeson once said, there's not a problem getting people to write, it's a problem getting people not to write. And so the person assigned will do the first draft, and that will be circulated. And then if somebody else likes that, they will circulate a one-line concurrence, and they might make some suggestions, which they'll say are not critical, or they might discuss it beforehand. And when that one-line concurrence has been circulated, then the author of the draft will say, can I join you? And then it becomes a joint judgment of two of them. And then sometimes you get a cascade of those concurrences, maybe with or without additional suggestions, and that's how a joint judgment is built up. And sometimes it's everybody, so it becomes a unanimous judgment of the court. Occasionally, you'll get collaboration between the writer of a first draft and somebody else, and they will circulate it first off as a joint draft of the two of them. I have always made it clear to our judges, and particularly the new ones as they come on, and there have been five since I was appointed, that there is no rule that people can't write separately if they want to. And every now and again, people will write separately. And I think that's a healthy thing, because it shows that each judge has his or her own voice, and that when they join in, it's not rubber stamping, it is a full intellectual assent, because they have a choice. They can write or they can join in. But I don't like the idea of, personally, I've never liked the idea of having protocols or rules about these things. The moment you set up a protocol or a rule, you then have questions about what it means and whether somebody's breached it and so forth. It's much better to let these things evolve in a collegial way. Now, everything depends critically then for the success of that process upon the personalities and the personal chemistry. Now, sometimes you'll find some people are writing separately more than others. That doesn't bother me in the least. I mean, that's just a function of personality, and it changes over time. And I don't think one needs to get too upset about that. So far as the profession is concerned, and judges in courts who have to act on our decisions, of course, they prefer joint judgments.
And one can law students also.
Of course. And one can understand that. But you can't please everybody. I mean, at one stage, the court was producing a whole lot of separate judgments and people saying, we can't find a ratio, you know, it's awful. It's too much work, more work for lawyers than should be. And then we started producing a whole lot more joint judgments. And then there are people saying, oh, this is judgment by committee. You know, people are compromising, they're seeking their intellectual integrity. So one doesn't worry about that kind of criticism.
Lawyers are a fun group. So you talk about the process of making decisions. You've been involved in a lot of judgments over the years. It's always hard to predict these things, but which judgment that you've been involved in do you think will have the most influence going on the development of Australian law?
Look, I don't know. And the reason I say that is because the influence that a particular judgment will have may well depend upon what happens down the track, contingencies that I can't control or can't foresee, the kinds of cases that come before us, and the composition of the court. If I were asked to pick out a judgment which I think is particularly significant, I would think Kirk is of considerable importance, because that has created a kind of pervasive rule of law provision, if you like, implication applicable in the states. As well as, and territories as well as, in the states I should say, as well as the sort of 75-5 that we have under the Constitution for the entrenched judicial review jurisdiction of the High Court. So I think that Kirk is particularly important. People may talk about Pape and Williams in terms of the executive power, and certainly they are very important constitutional decisions. But the question is, how much practical impact will they have down the road? I don't know the answer to that. Pape and Williams were particular kinds of litigants. It's pretty unusual to get somebody who's going to sue the government that wants to give them a check. I called Mr. Pape, but he was a delightful fellow, and it's very sad that he died a couple of years ago. He represented himself before us. But I called him the man who tried to bite the hand that tried to feed him. And you know, litigants like that don't often turn up. Then Mr. Williams, of course, had a particular concern about school chaplaincy programs for reasons which had nothing much to do with federal funding. They had to do with religion in schools. And, you know, the Section 116 issue was parked pretty quickly. So it might depend upon the future shape of executive spending programs. If you have executive spending programs which introduce coercive or prescriptive elements, then there might be pushback in that area. I'm just not sure. We'll have to wait and see.
Well, we might turn now to the audience. We have time for a handful of questions. What we might do is collect perhaps a few questions and then hand back to the Chief Justice. Could I ask you to raise your hand if you have a question? I'll ask you to give your name, the institution that you're attached to, law student or firm or so forth, and I will ask you to be concise and to ask a question rather than deliver a judgment, make a statement, unburden yourself of your biography. So with those constraints in mind, please put up your hand if you have a question for the Chief.
Don't ask me to explain my reasons.
They're all available on Ostley. Justice Dobelton.
Just a very quick question, really a matter of history of the High Court. Your proposal procedure for putting the cases before the judges, is that a policy, in fact, initiated by Sir Garfield Barwick, I think? And it's quite different from the policy that Sir Owen Dixon might have had.
I think that might be right. Bruce, you probably know more about it than I do, but I think it does probably date back to that time. Although Barwick could be a bit prescriptive, I think. There was more of the, in fact, I think the notion of the collegial administration might have been something that he didn't necessarily support.
Cheryl Saunders, Melbourne Law School. Chief Justice, one of the other things that's happened during your time as Chief Justice is that the court's become more open in many ways. You've put submissions online, it's much easier to trace the process of litigation, and there may be other things as well along those lines. I just wondered whether you could comment on those developments and how they came about and how significant you think they've been.
Yes, I think we've been inspired to some extent by movements in other courts. And certainly our Chief Executive and Principal Registrar, Andrew Phelan, has been a great promoter of that. And Justice Hayne, when he was on the court, was also a very keen supporter of the electronic filing and the exposure of the submissions. And I think that I've noticed that having the submissions, particularly on the website, particularly in high-profile cases, has meant that the press, when they're reporting on a high-profile case, will report on the base what is being said and, by reference to the submissions. I think that's a very useful development. And the summaries that we put out, of course, they've been going for quite some time. I think they are fundamentally important as well. The people who have to report quickly online or in print media, what the court has said in a complex and long judgment, has to have some reasonably comprehensible account of it that can be picked up very quickly off a single page. Those press releases, incidentally, are drafted normally by one or other of the associates, and then they are circulated around, and we all have an input into them. They're not reasons of the court, and that disclaimer goes on, but we're all very concerned, and certainly as Chief Justice, I've been very concerned that they offer as comprehensible as possible an account to those who have to report on what we're doing very quickly, what happens. And of course, we haven't gone to the stage of the Supreme Court in the UK, which I think holds press conferences or press briefings in advance, but there are resource issues there as well. The other thing that's been of importance, although it's probably terribly boring for some people, is the audiovisual record of the arguments before the court. Where I think you've typically seen just the judges' faces and the back of the heads of counsel. But I see that as a significant advance, and I hope that we'll be able to do better than that down the track and make it look a bit more interesting and maybe even get to the live streaming that the UK Supreme Court has, although that has a backup with a kind of in-house production studio that we don't have. But I understand there's been some feedback from, particularly from the academic sector, that students find it of interest to watch the actual argument in the case of which they know something, they've read the submissions and
Absolutely.
So forth.
Yeah, they're binge watchers of High Court. They sit up till 3 o'clock in the morning desperate to get the most recent.
I can't believe there is such an animal as a binge
watcher.
Thank you. Jane Reynolds Foundation, 1901. Did our founders get the Constitution right? And if you had the opportunity, in a hypothetical sense, of course, what would you like to tell them or ask them?
Well, I think they got it right for their times, and they got it right to this extent, that they saw it as a document for the future. There was a quote which I'd collected somewhere here, and one of my favourites is John Downer, in the Melbourne Convention in 1898, one of the Adelaide delegates, who said, and this was about the future interpretation of the Constitution, and he said, "With judges rests the interpretation of intentions which we may have in our minds, but which have not occurred to us at the present time. With them rests the obligation of finding out principles which are in the minds of this convention in framing this bill and applying them to cases which had never occurred before and which are very little thought of by any of us." And Isaacs, in the same convention, said, with a bit more judicial imperialism about him, he wasn't a judge at that time, of course, he was a delegate, we have taken infinite trouble to express what we mean in this Constitution, but as in America, so it will be here, that the makers of the Constitution were not merely the conventions who sat and the states who ratified their conclusions, but the judges of the Supreme Court." So in other words, now, of course, Greg Craven has written something, I think, some extension saying this didn't really necessarily reflect a progressive interpretation approach. Nevertheless, it does reflect an understanding that this was a document for the future. And I think that's perhaps the most important thing about it. It has all the charisma, of course, of a boring joint venture arrangement. It doesn't have any, if you look at the preamble, you compare it to the preamble of many constitutions around the place. Bhutan is the high point, I think. "We, the people of Bhutan, blessed by the luminosity of the triple gem, give ourselves," etc. This is, it's a very prosaic sort of preamble. And it doesn't have any ringing declaration of values. It doesn't have any, as we know, any entrenched human rights, apart from the very few guarantees which everybody is aware of. In fact, a senior English judge a couple of years ago said to me, thought that we expressed the view that we didn't have a constitution because we didn't have a Bill of Rights. So I gave that judge a copy of our constitution inscribed with the words, "No Bill of Rights, but it seems to work." Now, there are, of course, controversial questions about, for example, implications. Implication always seems to be controversial because it's not there in the text, and whether an implication is justified or not. But that has nothing to do, in the end, with the rightness or wrongness of the approach taken by the people who drafted it. I thought the more I read of what they said and what they did, I think it was a terrific achievement, and one which should be celebrated more in this country. Most people don't know who our founding fathers are. And when you look at the diversity of interests, they weren't all lawyers by any means, the absence of any revolutionary impulse, any great nation building, it was coming together out of necessity in a sense. I think it was a remarkable outcome. Now, there's no doubt that there's some reworking that could be done. And one important piece of reworking, I think, would be recognition of the Indigenous people. I don't see that is going to somehow, as Leslie Zines once said, mocking something somebody else said, act like some sort of lymph node pumping things into the interpretive problems into the Constitution. I think recognition of the Indigenous people as the first people of this continent is simply part of recognising an important element of our national identity. It can't be put into the same basket as just recognising one race. It's recognising a special part of our history. So I don't see a problem at all with that, and I think the Constitution would be improved if we had it. How precisely it's to be done, of course, I don't want to comment on. I know there are ongoing debates and whether there should be substantive provisions and so forth, but the recognition part certainly I have no problem with.
Well, thank you. It was a great question. Opened up some interesting ideas. And we're almost out of time, so I might just ask you a final question, if I may, Chief Justice. We have a lot of law students and recent law graduates here tonight. What advice would you have for people at the start of their careers at law or the end of their time at law school?
Well, first of all, there are many people who do law degrees who aren't necessarily going to be legal practitioners. So and that was, of course, my conception when I finished law. I wasn't sure that I was going to be a legal practitioner. A law degree has a huge variety of useful purposes. Secondly, if you are going to be a legal practitioner, you should keep an open mind about where the path of your career is going to take you. Don't lay down a celestial blueprint right at the start, because it might lock you in and close off opportunities that might otherwise arise. I've often said also that early specialisation is a serious error. I really do think that the generalist skills are of fundamental importance. I remember some years ago speaking at a gala dinner in Western Australia for National Association of Law Students, and I spoke about specialisation and generalisation, and I said if you specialise too early or too long, it'll rot your brains. Now, I went back down to the table and sat next to some young student who was an office bearer in the organisation, and she said to me, I'm not going to specialise too early. She said, I'm going to do across the board tax and only go to GST later. At which point, a profound depression overcame me and I tried to drown myself in my soup. Now, can I say, many of you, of course, the way the profession is structured these days, whether you're going to be barristers or solicitors, will end up as specialists or academics. You'll end up with a special focus in your practice or a specialist focus. The only thing I say to you is that you cannot be a good specialist unless you are also a generalist, because there is no area of the law that can be siloed from any other. I spoke a few years ago to a group called the Superannuation Lawyers. Think about superannuation law. It sounds like the narrowest, but it's contract, it's equity, it's labour relations, it's constitution, and it's public law because it's regulatory. So specialisation is not a comfort zone. It requires great expertise, but it also requires being able to recognise its intersections with the whole web of legal issues that might arise in particular problems. So that's my advice.
Well, that's wonderful advice on which to end things. My thanks for your time, Chief Justice, and I'll call on Adrian Stone to give a formal vote of thanks.
Well, it's my pleasure, on behalf of the Law School and the Australian Association of Constitutional Law, to thank the Chief Justice for joining us tonight and for taking us on that fascinating journey from aspiring theoretical physicist to Chief Justice of Australia. It's a journey that, at least viewed at its starting point, had a somewhat unexpected end, I think. But it's a journey also that shows, both in the diversity of its starting point and of so many of the stops along the way, the important connections between law, judging, and so many areas of human endeavour. I know there are many students tonight, and I hope and I feel sure that they will be inspired in their careers to seek to emulate the energy and open-mindedness to a diversity of experience, and of course the strong commitment to justice that your career has shown. I think this perhaps might be the last time you will join us at Melbourne Law School as a sitting Chief Justice of the High Court of Australia, but I very much hope that we will welcome you here again and again in the future. On behalf of the Law School and the Australian Association of Constitutional Law, please join me in thanking the Chief Justice.